Hello there, I'm your new neighbor.
Started in 1983, and I had been playing with Ronald Shannon Jackson in a sort of a progressive improvising context. I got to this point where I really needed to make a break and at least see what was in here, you know?
I was like a working actor for 7 years, like doing the rounds. Oh, you have to know the latest trend or the latest dance craze so you can do these commercials for these, for some silly ass peanut butter commercial. Or it was a grind, but I loved it. I had a really good time because I was actually doing something that I loved to do and realized that that was where my niche was, that I wanted to be a performer and do anything to be a performer.
I don't know. I'd go to college.
Me too.
If I had the money.
Yeah.
So what are you gonna do?
I don't know. What are you gonna do?
Vernon called me up to audition for the band. No one ever told me that I didn't have the job. It was like I was rehearsing and rehearsing and rehearsing. I think this was after I got back from doing Platoon, and I came back and I was doing all this rehearsing. But I still don't know whether I got the job or not. That's what it is. I'm still waiting to hear from somebody to tell me I got the job.
This is all great and shit, but we had to come in.
I was touring with Harry Belafonte on and off, mostly doing like Vegas, Denver, and Atlantic City and stuff like that. I had my own band. I was trying to get my band in New York. And he called me for a gig. I went out to Brooklyn. That afternoon, rehearsed all day, packed everything in my van. That's where I met Corey. There was a different bass player at that time. We drove out to Maxwell's in Hoboken, New Jersey, and that was my first gig with Living Color.
My father was a fire chief, so I took the test, scored really high, took the written part, and then it was funny because I mean, literally, I went back and forth because I could see living either way.
So I said to him, listen, whenever you make a decision, just call, let me know what you're gonna do.
Just let me down easy.
Really?
No.
You know
what
would have been rude if he just came in with a hat?
With a
just came in with a fire hat and a big axe on his belt. Yo, guys, man, I'm gonna do this rehearsal today, but I got a job after this.
And the free down on Wall Street, I gotta go to.
I tell you though, I tell you.
With his overcoat and a big huge red hat with a number on it.
Man, when Muzz called me up to say that, it was like two things, you know. It was like, number one, he had passed the fire exam. I mean, he passed his final exam, and essentially he could be a fireman. And then he said, but I'm not gonna do it. I'm gonna stay with the band. That, I was so happy. You know, I tried to contain my glee.
CBGB show.
It was like 1986, and we were really starting to like
October and November of 86.
Yeah, we started to play a lot down there, three or four times a month maybe. Yeah.
We may not have been cohesive all the time, 100%, but there was always this incredible energy that we had and this vengeance that we played with.
It started actually at Princeton. These guys were just like so into it, and just so it seemed like they were like starved for some sort of like musical expression, that they broke wild, and I loved it, and I had to be a part of it. I had to make myself a part of it. So I said, the only way I'm going to be a part of it is to get myself in there. And there was like a wall of people in front of me, so I said, I'm jumping over you. And that's where the stage diving started.
we first started rehearsing, it was really cool. And we did a bunch of rehearsals, and we went out to play, and it just was, it was, it just
caca.
Wasn't there.
Fufu caca.
Early gigs, Will would just do something that was like amazing. He would just do something that would make me go, what's going on? But checking out Mr. Glover over here, he used to freak out like he was having a crazy fit. And he would just like freak out and scream and scream. And I was totally amazed that someone could scream like that with that much energy.
I was having
and then
a flashback.
I've played with different bands and played with different people where when a guitarist would solo, he would,
Waltz.
You know, he would start in, take it out, and then come back. Whereas Vernon would start out, drop in a little while, and then leave.
You had that terrifying gig at the
Vietnam Veterans War Memorial.
That Vietnam Vets gig was one of those days when you ask yourself, like, why did I pick up sticks?
What
insane thing influenced me to become a musician?
That's nice. Whenever we played, it was like
a new adventure.
It was like the sounds that come out of this guitar were like really out. So we got to the point where Muzzy and I could imitate the sounds. Yeah.
That was rude when I did on it.
We did it on a gig.
That was rude.
We did it on a gig of Trance.
Instead of Vernon playing, Vernon stopped playing literally, and we continued. He was like,
you can tell I was terribly hurt in the by the whole sordid incident.
I got a job at Clairol. And I was working as a hair color consultant. So I would change the color of my hair every other week. And the more I got into it, the stranger it got, and the longer my hair got, and the stranger the colors got. So, and this is what happened.
My father at the time did not understand what I was doing.
Boy, what you doing?
When I would come up to the house, I had to cut my hair and started growing it like this with dreads on top and cut the sides. So I would walk over and like ring the bell, and his father would just open the door and just look.
You gotta be kidding me, man.
Baby Power!
What is memorable about that band?
Blake Singer's hair.
There's no accounting for taste.
I say, any way that they can get it, just get it. You know, just as long as you understand the music.
I'm glad that they like any aspect. You know, if they like Corey's hair or, you know, the way that neoprene fits him, then that's okay.
Eventually they'll get it. My hair has nothing to do with it.
Out with the old and in with the new.
When I speak out.
We had an association with Mick Jagger from before. You know, he worked on the first record, producing two songs as demos, and he was really familiar with us, and he had actually come to CBGB's to check us out.
They were around 10 years before I left.
That's right. That's
not the same. Well, almost 10 years.
Almost close.
Close, you see, 10 years.
4 years.
4 years.
You know, we met right before the record came out. We met when he was doing his last solo record. And I never forget the audition, and I was standing there. It was horrible. And he just like, he was wearing sweatpants. And I was like, oh, that's Mick Jagger. And he walked right up to me and said hello and introduced himself. It's cool. And he invited me over to his house.
It's the only guitar player that had a wah-wah pedal. So it's funny how you remember what you remember.
It was funny, you know, because after he saw the band, I went over to one of his several houses.
Yeah.
I went to the nice one.
You helped flag them to Epic
Event. Well, yeah, a little bit.
I helped a lot. He was a great producer.
We decided it would be a good idea to grab a new audience and to play this music for some people who maybe wouldn't normally check out a Living Color show or wouldn't even really focus on four black gentlemen doing anything for that matter.
I tell you, I'll never forget. And we drove and you saw the stage. I was like, okay, so there's a building. What's that building? Where's the stage?
Ladies and gentlemen,
the
Revolution. Basically what it was a prayer. What I thought about was we need a moment to get in tune with each other, to feel each other out quietly, and to understand each other's rhythm, each other's heartbeat.
First show in a few days.
A settle in.
Be on your toes.
Pour some cement.
That'll do it.
Four is one. Four is one.
We've got two tickets!
We are very late!
It's showtime!
Those gigs have been really memorable for us. It started right from the moment that we all get in our circle. It's like
you're connected. And there's nothing that's gonna break that connection.
I know you're anger, I know you're Thank you.
See, my mind was blown from the first gig, the first show, and the second show. But after the third show, they're good.
Oh, stadiums.
No.
Bag of shells.
Bag of shells.
Four stories?
It came easy, and it went just as fast.
Doesn't get any bigger than New York, Shea Stadium. You know what I'm saying?
The guys beat the Twins. Security Twins.
Hey, you heard about Joe
much too early. I'm getting off a bus. I'm going to the hotel.
Ask yourself, what does Living Color do when they arrive in Indianapolis at 9 o'clock in the morning and the rooms aren't ready? Go ahead, Marcel.
I love you.
What's the worst thing about being an opening act?
No sound checks. Getting the stage painted before you go on.
And people not really caring much about whether you play well or not, actually.
Y'all feel all right? I can't hear you. Guess what? We're in the Living Color.
Sound check.
It did.
This motherfucker
it was
felt
bad.
Like sound check.
It felt like getting nothing
felt
back.
Like security was out there. That's what I felt from the drum visor.
It was like putting out.
We enjoy playing so much, I don't think it really makes a difference.
Four of us have fun. That's probably the highest part of the show. Any show. But no matter what, we're all gonna have fun.
This is a daisy age.
Ladies and gentlemen, I recommend this to anyone. Anyone.
Gotta get burning and eat some watermelon and get it on film.
There you go, Byron.
Woo!
Maybe hardcore, man.
I think the watermelon has actually gotten a very, very bad rap. It's a delicious fruit with that guitar in your hand and a hat. Quite nutritious. Quite nutritious. And it's been unfortunately associated with racial stereotypes of African Americans.
Then eat it.
I think that the watermelon, far from being a part of the racist imagery that's a, go on, racist, eat it.
It's the last time we're gonna have an opportunity to show them what we got in a larger space. So let's give it to them really hard, you know what I'm saying?
And we played It's Only Rock and Roll with them last night. And it was really emotional. It was really moving because, you know, we'd spent a whole bunch of time with these people and with the crew. And they, you know, after a while, you know, you get really cool with people.
Thank you.
We had finished the Stones tour, and then we took some time off, much needed time, and then we went to pre-production. We were kind of like in an experimental mode when we came up with the songs and their arrangements.
How fast can we play to have the parts still coherent? Do a shot. Go ahead.
A lot of time to do what we finished ahead of time. Recorded about 19 songs. It was great to go out to LA in a different environment and do this
completely
next album.
Different environment.
It's gonna be great. Right now it sucks.
I like about Time's Up is that, you know, I get to do like weird shit, you know, like really, you know, there's a moment of pure noise, like the introduction to Information Overload. I love that. And the thing is that it works in terms of the song.
We don't want it to be machine-like, you know?
No, it sounds good.
It's breathing. It's definitely breathing. Okay,
it's
you guys are behind it. I'm with you all the way.
Yeah, it's great. It's cool. Well, it's good.
It's great. It's not okay.
Slam it!
Outstanding.
It's great. I love it.
It's kind of a step away from the last record. The whole album is, for that matter, but...
It ain't Cult of Personality. That's what it ain't.
Type. The buzzword syndrome, I think, is what that's all about. The video and the song itself sort of like talk about that you know, you're this vast wasteland that you're in, where all you get are these little bits of information that's supposed to teach you everything, supposed to give you everything.
Nigerian Prince, Mbutu and Bang Bang.
The back is solid. Note the flesh tones.
You have the skull tie.
Very nice.
Very nice. The Sgt. Pepper shirt. Lovely.
Note the chest exposure for the erotic effect.
The brand new model jeans. Splendid.
Nice guitar.
And we also have the time. Yes. Image is about bringing forth certain realities, you know. You know, we're sober. We're sane. We mean what we say. We're out to have a good time. We're positive about our heritage. We're positive about human life, you know. And that's really, you know, and we're not afraid of looking people like right in the eye and letting them know where we're coming from. We'll be right back.
struggling to maintain decency tonight.
Well, that's how it felt. You see, there was a cat on my side that kept giving me the finger. It was a guy, like a skinhead guy. It was like, there were these two, it was like, he was sitting next to a guy and they were having this intense argument. Because one guy would clap, and the other guy kept giving me the finger like the whole time. I mean, this shit was really out. So then,
it's like, you know, you hate to see people's worst aspects. You know? It really is. It's really a drag. What can you do? And I certainly didn't get into playing music with the expectation of everyone liking it, everyone liking me, or even, you know, people understanding. But, you know, all of that understanding and knowing what that is does not help when you got somebody in your face.
And it's not about once we get off the stage, it's over. You know, sometimes we still can't hail cabs. We still get pulled over.
We get mail that's very hateful and very, like, very ignorant.
You know, Mick said to me that, you know, when we played here before, this was a segregated stadium, and that's heavy.
If you want to make this world a better place, you better start understanding people and not, you know, and deal with people with respect.
In Africa, music is not an art form as much as it is a means of communication.
We wanted to end up that tour kind of like how we started. We played stadiums and it was great, but we wanted to come back home to where it started and where our roots were.
One other thing about it is, it's whether you can go home again. And I was wondering if, you know, we, without the big gestures and the 300-foot stage to run around on, if we could, you know, really put that across. And it was really great.
War is hell.
Peace is hell.
Love is hell.
I do believe that musically we'll always have something, you know, something provocative to say, something that won't be, how do I put it, run of the mill. We're not going to sit and repeat ourselves.
I think we're going to continue to move and evolve and progress and push ourselves as far as we possibly can until we don't want to be pushed anymore.
I'd like to keep breaking ground and let people know that this is a very serious band with a very serious message. And they should take heed.
I mean, I tell you, I'd love to change the world. I'd love for the world to be changed, for us to all get together and do it. I just want people to at least give it a shot.
What's your favorite color, baby? What's your favorite color? What's your favorite color, baby? What's your favorite color? What's your favorite color, baby? What's your favorite color? What's your favorite color, baby? What's your favorite color? What's your favorite color, baby? I can't hear you. What's your favorite color, baby? Little louder, a little louder. What's your favorite color, baby? What's that? What's your favorite color, baby? Come on, fellas, let's go. What's your favorite color, baby? Well, hey.